Today, the Switch turns a year old. Can Nintendo keep the momentum going? Looks like Nintendo's in a little bit of legal trouble with the EU, but really, who isn't these days? And are gamers too busy focusing on what might be coming up next to enjoy what they currently have? Find out on Hello Nintendo. Hey everyone, thanks for joining me today. It is episode 29 of Hello Nintendo. I'm your host Matt, aka Trainass, and joining me again today is Amogh, aka Casterman.
Hey, what's up guys?
How's it going?
I'm doing alright, and yourself?
Oh, doing pretty good for Saturday. It snowed overnight, so I gotta go shovel after we do this. I'm not looking for
it. Nice and warm over here.
Yeah, make me jealous. I'll be happy once winter's over. I hate winter.
Oh yeah.
I'm a terrible soon. Canadian. So it's been a little while since we've had you on the pod, and why don't we start off with what we've been playing this week. So why don't we'll start with you. What have you been playing the past week, Amogh?
Oh god, I'm the worst. I recently got myself back into League of Legends. That is the absolute worst game I could possibly get into right now. For people who don't know, that is a multiplayer online battle arena. So it's 5-on-5, top-down, and each game takes roughly around like 30 to 40 minutes, sometimes more, sometimes less. And there's a level progression system within the game, but it resets every single game. It's very, very addictive.
Yeah, I've had a couple guys at work try to get me into League, but I just...
Don't do it.
I can't do it.
Don't.
anything else, or have you just been pretty much head deep into League?
See, that's the kind of game that will just draw you and pull you in, and you won't really want to play anything else. And so in the Nintendo sphere, I've been a little bit lacking recently. Besides, of course, the standard Mario Kart.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. I have been playing a lot of Darksiders on... still playing Darksiders on Xbox One, as well as the Sea of Thieves beta. Whenever Rare opens that up, it's usually over a weekend, so I usually dive right into that. And I finally picked up Bayonetta 1 and 2 on the Switch.
Really? How are they?
I've only started playing the first one, and it feels just like your typical kind of adventure, action adventure fighter type of type of game. But it's pretty awesome. It's very fluid, I find. Very fluid. And it plays quite nicely on the Switch.
Okay.
And, like, I've only really completed the first section after the opening cutscene. You're in a graveyard. And I thought that was pretty good. So I'm looking forward to keep playing that. Because I do quite like that style of game. I like those games. So, and... It is at that point that I realized 128 gig micro SD card is not big enough, and I'm gonna have to.
128 gig micro SD card isn't big enough.
Yeah, I've only got about 20 gigs free, so that's maybe one or two more games, depending on what it is. On my Wii U, I went pretty much all digital, but that's because I had a physical hard drive plugged into it. So I have up.
That's something that's a little bit difficult here.
Yeah, the Switch doesn't support physical hard drives, so I think I'm going to have to kind of do like a hybrid. I was talking to a bunch of people online, and what they do, what seems like what a lot of people do is they do kind of like a hybrid type of thing where they go physical for like a lot of the first party and the big games, and then they go digital for the smaller ones, as well as the you know, indie titles. So I'm thinking I'm gonna have to do that because storage is at a premium right now. Micro SD cards are expensive. Right.
Oh my god, tell me about it. I feel like micro SD cards, for some reason, have not gone down in price all that much in the past year either. I've been on the hunt for a while. That might just be me, though.
I think it all depends on what size. Anything substantial is going to be expensive. Like, I was looking at the 400 gig micro SD card, and that's like $200-$300 Canadian on Amazon. Really? Whereas, like, a 128... you know, or even like a 64 gig is you can get them for less than $100, which isn't too bad, but because there's no because there's no, you can't have like a hard drive connected up to it. I'm kind of boned.
That's true. At least for me, for micro SD cards and some of that smaller storage, I always go for, if it's more than like $1 a gigabyte, that's too much for me.
No, that's fair.
But
that's fair. I mean,
50
I remember
cents
when
a gigabyte
SD...
soon.
Yeah. Yeah, so looks like but I mean, one of the advantages of switching over to physical is that I'll be able to start taking more advantage of sales and stuff, you know, buy one get one free kind of things at Best Buy and GameStop and whatnot. So it's got its pros and cons. I just now need to find lots of shelf space for all these games. So,
well, luckily for the Switch, the boxes are smaller. If you're one of the people that likes to hold on to the boxes,
yes.
Although the biggest con, I'd say, is the physical act of getting up and switching the game.
Yeah. You got so spoiled with you know, the Xbox and PlayStation, even the Wii U, and even the Wii, really.
Oh yeah,
where you can
all
your entire library right there, and you don't have to get off your couch like the fat, lazy person you are. But that
Man, you know me so well.
But this leads us into our very first news topic, which is the Nintendo Switch one-year anniversary. So we're recording on March 3rd, and today is actually launch day. Well, was launch day 2017 for the Nintendo Switch. My Facebook feed has just been absolutely full of people with, you know, where were you on launch day for the Switch, and reminiscing and everything. Even a couple of the pictures that I posted where I first got it came up. And it's been a pretty big first year for Nintendo after the bomb that was the Wii U, and they just came out swinging with the Switch, and they've done a phenomenal job. I mean, when you look at the sales numbers, they're doing amazing, and it's kind of funny and kind of sad as well, but Nintendo is just beating the pants off of Microsoft lately for sales as of late. I mean, I think overall console sales, I think because Xbox has got a little bit more, had a head start, they're doing a bit better. But month over month, Nintendo's kind of puts the question in the future of the Xbox now.
That's true. And naysayers will say that, oh, the reason why the Switch is doing better is because it's a newer system. But through historical evidence, we know that that's not the case. Considering the PS4 has massive, massive amounts of sales over the Xbox One and One X and One S, I guess. The market has probably not seen critical mass on sales for the Xbox One.
So, what did in the past year? What are some of your impressions on this system? Like, what do you think? Did it? Because I remember we were all talking when Nintendo finally unveiled that first video, where it showed the console, showed what it could do. That was towards the end of 2016.
It was, I think October. I think it was November. Yeah.
November, October, November, something like that. And, you know, we finally got to see that it's a hybrid system. The controllers come off, the whole thing, and the internet just exploded. Everybody was so hyped for this. How has it impressed you in the past year? What do you think?
So, I'm one of the people that almost exclusively uses the Switch docked. it's just easier for me. I'm usually playing games with friends on it, and so I'd rather be playing with a TV screen than on the Switch screen itself. But what's really impressed me is just how quickly you can bounce between going docked and going, well, on the TV screen. Or, I mean, on the Switch itself, sorry.
Yeah.
I can't imagine. Now I'm getting even more spoiled. More spoiled than just, oh, I don't want to switch the game card. Now I'm like, oh, well, you know what? If one, I want to play on the go. I want to play on the go immediately. In the time it takes me to pull the Switch out of the dock, I'm doing some little hand motions. Matt, only you can see me doing this right now. Just imagine, I'm pulling the Switch out of the dock, and by the time I get settled and can actually play, oh, I just, if this is The Legend of Zelda, I just died because I waited too long.
Yeah. No, I think I play primarily with it connected up to my TV, but now that my kids are starting to get more into video games, I'm finding I'm taking advantage of its, the fact that I can just remove it from the dock. Same with, you know, my Xbox and the remote play. Though both of those systems do that perfectly. So I'm finding that just in the past few months, I'm starting to play it in handheld a little bit more. It also lets my kids just kind of, I mean, regardless if I'm playing on the TV or not, they like to sit next to me and watch what I'm doing. But I'm kind of mixed between how I play it.
Right.
What do you think
back
of the...
when I was...
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, back when I was at home, I think I used the handheld mode a little more often, just because TV space was at a premium in the household.
Yep. What do you think of the Joy-Cons?
I like the Joy-Cons. I think that the controllers, well, they felt really small earlier. Mm-hmm. Now that the majority of the time I spend playing with the controller is the Joy-Con controllers, or the Joy-Cons in the Joy-Con grip.
Yeah.
I find that if I'm using a different controller now, it feels sort of like a little hulking mass, even though the majority of my life has been played with regularly sized controllers.
Mm-hmm. I really only use the Joy-Cons when I'm playing in handheld mode. I can't even use them in the grip. I just can't do it. They're too small. It just feels too uncomfortable. And like the grip just even makes it feel too narrow. I just can't do it. The only time I like using those Joy-Cons is in handheld. I don't even use them because you can take them off and just, you know, use them as regular controllers. Just kind of sitting. I've tried doing that a couple times. That's just awkward. It just feels so awkward.
Well, when you have them like sideways and doing it like that, or
well, like cause you can hold them. You can hold them vertical. You can pretty much hold it as you're holding a controller, just not together. That feels awkward. And like even sideways, they're tiny. They just feel too small. Like I've got big hands. And I'm sure my kids they'll probably have no problem with them because they've got tiny hands. So it's going to be more normal for them. But no,
right.
You know, I've got two of the Switch Pro controllers, and I'm planning on picking up a couple of the 8-bit Doe controllers that they updated, or the new ones that they released that have better Switch support. And then that way, I'll at least have my four, you know, physical controllers. Excuse me. My one Joy-Con, my left Joy-Con, I changed it out so it's got a physical D-pad on it now. So I can't really use it sideways anymore. Yeah, I put a clear shell on it just because I like the way it looks. And I replaced the four buttons with the D-pad. And it actually feels really nice. The D-pad is very similar to the D-pad that's not even the one on the Switch Pro controller. I don't know, it's got a nice little kind of concave to it, and it's got a good button travel. I mean, you're just replacing the buttons with a plus, but it actually makes handheld mode that much nicer, being able to use a D-pad.
Wait, so did you just pulled out the buttons and just put in the D-pad on top of that then?
Yeah, so it's a whole, like, pretty much, it's a whole new shell. So you're replacing the whole shell for the Joy-Con.
Oh.
And where the top of the shell, instead of it having the circles for the buttons, it's replaced with the D-pad. So, and it still uses all the regular, like, the rubber pad and everything. It still uses all those. It's right. Just instead of it being four individual buttons, it's a D-pad. So you do have to replace the whole shell in order to do this, get this to work. It's not something you just kind of snap on. No, I'm sure.
No, that's really interesting. I actually prefer the four buttons instead of the single D-pad. I feel like I'm able to get a little bit more accurate of a result. Because I am one of those people that rolls around their thumb. Mm-hmm. But it just sort of fits, I guess, my style with the four buttons.
Yeah, I find Breath of the Wild is much, like, because that's what I play when I use the D-pad a little bit more. I find Breath of the Wild is much better with a D-pad versus the buttons. But that's just me.
Hmm. Yeah, I guess everybody's got their preferences.
Yeah. Yeah, if those of you listening, if you are want to pick up something like this or even just look at it, you can actually, if you go to Amazon, that's where I found this. And if you do just even a search for clear Joy-Con, you're going to end up finding them. They're made by a company called Bass Top, however you want to pronounce it. It's a portable do-it-yourself replacement housing, and they've got so many different colors. Holy cow. They've got colors. So they've got solid colors. They've got the transparent colors. So you can even get the atomic purple. If you really like that atomic purple. I think that was what? The N64 had the atomic purple?
I think the Game Boy Advance, GameCube, you know? Also had. Or are you talking like the translucent purple?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I think that was N64. Game Boy and the N64 had it.
Yeah. Okay, so you can get the jungle green, because I've got the jungle green N64 sitting right next to me. You can get the atomic purple. You can get ice blue. They've got, they call it watermelon red. You can get pure white. You can get smoke black. You can get crystal clear. And they carry both. And the cool thing is that they've all got the Famicom or the Super Famicom colors for the buttons, because you get all brand new buttons with them as well. Or you can get them with a D-pad. And then they also, you can get also a complete set where it's got the Joy-Cons and also just a replacement back for the Switch itself. So you can make it kind of all match and everything, which is kind of cool. So, yeah, it's okay. Not too expensive. For a set, and it's got the left Joy-Con with the D-pad, plus then a matching right Joy-Con with individual A, B, X, Y, you're looking at about $30 US. And if you were to, and then it's $37 US for the Switch housing and then two Joy-Cons, but then it's like a one for one, so you don't get the plus D-pad. It's $18 just for the Switch itself. You know what? I should have done that instead. I think I had a buddy of mine help me buy them. But yeah, if you want to switch them up, and it's fairly easy to do. Like the console itself, really? Pretty easy to do. Yeah, just just bunch of screws. It literally pops off. You have to replace the hardware for the kickstand, and then it just screws back into place. I've had no issues with mine. It fits perfectly in the dock. The Joy-Cons, though, you have to be very careful. There's a lot of very thin and small wires and ribbons, and those screws are ridiculously tiny. So tiny.
Okay, so for the Switch itself, that's something more of a beginner can do then, but for the Joy-Cons, maybe need a little bit of practice first?
Probably, yeah. I would have a spare set of Joy-Cons. Just in case. All right. Just in case. Because, all it's going to take is for you to snap one ribbon cable, whether it's on the battery or, you know, the motor or something like that. You got to be very careful.
I'm also assuming that this custom modding will require a tri-wing screwdriver.
Yeah. Yeah, you will need a tri-wing screwdriver. I think there's a few screws on... I think it's on the Joy-Con itself that used that tri-wing. You can actually get a screwdriver set. I know it sounds like I'm plugging Amazon a lot. We're not sponsored by anybody. I just find so much stuff on Amazon. You can actually get a screwdriver set. It's $11 on Amazon, and it's got the two different size tri-wing, a two, I think it's 2 millimeter, 1.5 millimeter. You've got your Phillips, a couple hex, and you know, looks like it's got everything in there. And then a guitar pick, so you can help pry stuff apart.
Oh, nice. So, or you can play the guitar with it, you never know.
Once you're done, you can go back and play guitar, yeah. But yeah, it's totally worth it. Definitely want, like, if you definitely want to do that, get a good set of screwdrivers and take your time. Take your time. There's lots of videos out there, so.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, actually, speaking of guitar, this is off topic almost entirely from this discussion. But with guitars, I was messing around with GarageBand the other day on my Mac, and I saw how there's like an app, so you can use GarageBand from your iPad.
Yeah.
I thought that would be something that could potentially be pretty neat on the Switch, especially with like the Labo and stuff. Nintendo seems like they're trying to gear themselves into more markets than just traditional video gaming, and so maybe going into that music sphere could be pretty cool.
So, like, creating new music or something like the Wii music coming to Switch?
I guess a little bit of both, actually. We already know from Nintendo Labo that there's the piano, and you can you can make a bunch of music from that. You can make loops and just straight songs from it. Nintendo can definitely do a lot more with that, I think.
Yeah, for sure. That would actually be kind of interesting. Having like a music creator on the Switch. It would kind of be like an evolution of the music creator from Mario Paint. Remember that music creator?
I'm actually not too familiar with Mario Paint.
Oh, man. Oh, you're missing out. Mario Paint was amazing. Any of the older listeners will know Mario Paint and how awesome it was with the mouse and everything. It was such a good game. I guess if you call it a game. Yeah, you need to look up Mario Paint. I know there's people that have even been trying to get Mario Paint working on the SNES Classic with modified controllers and everything. So that would be kind of cool. A music maker
on the Switch. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's just something that was on my mind, and I really wanted to bring that up.
Yeah. So, did you hear about this bug that seems to have a lot of people up in arms regarding playtime and how the Switch is reporting playtime?
Oh, yeah. Like, seeing as now we are exactly a year from the release, it seems like there's this weird bug that makes it so the Switch just deletes all your playtime a year later after you like first play a game.
Yeah, it's kind of a bug, but I don't know. That doesn't really bother me. If it says that I haven't played, you know, a game or whatever, as long as my save is fine. You know, as long as that doesn't get nuked. What do you think?
That's true.
Is this something that bugs you? I know I saw a few things on Reddit where people were kind of really pissy about this, and you know, but
that's true. Personally, I think that it's a little. I'm okay with this. I really don't like looking at my playtime on Steam because that's just oh god, I've thrown this many hours into this game. That's kind of crazy.
Yeah, my Left 4 Dead and Left 4 Dead 2 are like that. It's like, wow, if I had sat at my computer and played this straight, I'd been here for 2 months, nonstop. But, yeah,
it's like, half a month of playtime?
Yeah, see, it doesn't really bug me, but, I mean, it does bug some people. I guess because we don't have achievements, the Switch doesn't have an achievement system, that is kind of what people are using as their achievement, so I could see why some of them are upset.
Right.
But, yeah.
people like to feel a sense of progression while playing games.
Exactly. Exactly. But that's where the hero's path in Breath of the Wild, for example, comes into play, because you can see exactly where you go. And that's really cool to see. If you haven't played with that feature yet, give it a try.
You know, actually, with the hero's path mode, I wonder how the game tracks those hours. Do you think that it's based on inside the game itself, or do you think it takes the system hours of playtime?
It must do. There must be a counter within the game itself.
Right.
There's got to be a counter within the game. Some, you know, even tie, or even something tied into your game save. Because I know a lot of games will have their own internal timer, especially Final Fantasy games. So right. It's got to use something like that.
I'm sure. Yeah. Because if it had anything to do with the system tracking, then. That might be gone, although I haven't really heard anything about that.
Yeah, that's true. I'm sure there's a specific IGN editor who would be all over that. I remember hearing, I forget who it was, but was all upset and angry at Nintendo because he thought that his game save was overwritten when it was like his friend or his cousin or his brother or something just started a hero mode game of Breath of the Wild. And then he went back to the normal mode, and his save was there. Did you hear about that?
I think I did, and he got a little bit of a uproar on Reddit about that until people were like, "Oh, wait, what?"
Yeah,
looked into it.
Oh, and then he backpedaled pretty bad, but it's kind of funny.
Yeah, I wonder if he's still working there. I don't remember who it was.
Oh, probably. I don't think it's. I don't think it was that bad of a thing for them to fire him over.
That's true. Yeah. It wasn't that big either way.
No, that's true. Well, let's move on to our next topic. Nintendo has broken EU, so the European Union, law. So there is a. Norway has accused Nintendo of breaking, European consumer law, So the Norwegian Customer Council, they say that Nintendo denies European customers the option to get a refund on any pre-ordered games. Microsoft can do that. I think Sony can do as well. And, I've taken advantage of it once with Star Wars Battlefront 2. I refunded that pre-order there. But it looks like Nintendo doesn't. So you can preload games onto your system, but if it something happens, turns around, you don't want the game, don't need the game, or whatever, you're kind of stuck with that. What do you think? Do you think that Nintendo needs to kind of jump on board? Do you think Nintendo's going to change their policy now? Because right now it's only the EU that's throwing a fit about this. I haven't heard anything coming from North America. Regarding this issue, so do you think Nintendo's gonna change?
I guess if they're forced to, they will. I don't know. I feel like they might be doing that. They might just do that worldwide. Lately, they've been for the past few years, they've been all about having like similar features, having a sense of sameness in every single region. Mm-hmm. So it wouldn't be like that big of a jump for them to do that. And if they did happen to, change it and make it so you can refund preloaded games before the game is released, and say the US or some other regions add that law in, then Nintendo will be just fine.
Yeah. I think Nintendo does need to change. I think they need to give the option of canceling, being able to get a refund on a pre-order. It should be, obviously they'd have to do it somehow where the software then gets removed from your system. Because when you pre-order, if you were to pre-order a game, the preload doesn't start right away. It doesn't start usually until, a week before the game gets launched? Do you know? I don't, because I've only pre-ordered the Breath of the Wild DLC packs and the Mario Kart 8 DLC packs on Wii U So I've never actually preloaded software before on the Wii U or the Switch. Have you? Or
no, I don't think I've actually ever preloaded any software, come to think of it. That's just not something that I ever have to do. I don't tend to play games right away, right at the moment it's released, or the game is released.
Mm-hmm.
So that's never something that's really bothered me. And if I am pre-ordering a game, usually I'm pre-ordering a physical game, and only because there's some special bonus that like I want to get from it.
Yeah, I'm kind of the same. I've only pre-ordered a little bit of software, like just on my Xbox, a few games, and only had to get refunded on one. So it's going to be interesting to see, kind of see what happens.
Yeah, for sure.
There's a good Reddit thread on the gaming subreddit where they kind of talk about this, so you can check that out as well. And actually, one poster here. Makes a few good points about why you would want to be able to cancel a game. Say, let's say a release date changes and it's now, you know, let's say a game's not going to come out for another year or a year and a half, or the Battlefield 2 or Shadow of War situation where they add loot boxes and you can pretty much pay to you don't have to actually play the game to get everything. You can just spend all your money and do it. Or they're going to say, strip out features or something like that out of like a Switch copy, you know, or they make a huge change or something like that where you no longer want to support it. Those are all fairly good reasons why you would want to cancel your pre-order. And if you get a physical release, you just go back to wherever it is, you click cancel, you pretty much have up until the day it drops.
Right.
You know, and then even if you don't get it, you take it back to the store and get your money back. Digital software you're kind of stuck with.
Yeah, that's true, and that's one of the reasons I'm really iffy on purchasing digital in the first place, especially pre-ordering digital, because at least with physical, I still have to go up to the store, or maybe it's Amazon, but I can always return it very easily as long as I don't open it.
Yeah, exactly. Do you have any regret purchases? Software-wise, whether it's on a Nintendo system or really any, let's just go with any platform. Any game platform.
Well, in terms of the Switch, I actually only have a few games. I'm trying to change my purchasing philosophy for the Switch and for future consoles, specifically because of purchasing regret on prior platforms like. I guess Steam would be the biggest platform for that, because I'm always buying games and barely playing any of them, or just defaulting back to a free-to-play game, and such as League of Legends. I think the last purchase on Steam I had was Shadow of Mordor, I think, at least. And I actually have not even touched that game yet.
Oh really? I recommend. I enjoyed it when I played it. It's fun, especially when you can start stringing combos together and everything. It gets fun. I think you might like
it. Yeah, I just purchased it at an awkward time, and I can't actually run that on my computer.
Oh no!
I bought myself a MacBook specifically for the specifically to deter me from playing too many games on it. And obviously that failed, since I'm playing League of Legends.
Yeah.
But now that just means I can't play a wider variety of games. So maybe the Mac was a little bit of a regretful purchase in terms of gaming.
Yeah. That's true. Oh, well.
Don't tell Iwata fan in Nintendo.
I'm sure he'll find it out when he listens to this episode. For me, Command & Conquer 4 is probably the biggest regret I ever made for a purchase. I've got less than 90 minutes of playtime on it, and even then, that's 90 minutes too long. It's a horrible game. You can tell EA did not care about the Command & Conquer franchise. And there's actually a really good documentary. I think it's just like a fan-made documentary about the history of Command & Conquer. So if you like Command & Conquer, be sure to check it out, because it even talks about how CNC4 came to be and why it's such a crappy game. You know, Myst on the 3DS was also another regretful purchase of mine. Wish I'd never spent the money for that. I've got a couple... what was it? Mario Party. One of the last Mario Parties on the Wii U.
Ooh, the one... would that be Mario Party...
Is it Mario Party 10? Like,
I think Mario Party 10, yeah. I think Mario Party 9 was on...
I think that was on the Wii? Yeah, that was on the Wii.
Yeah.
I believe, yeah. Mario Party 10 was a Wii U title. Really wish I hadn't purchased that. I think I've played it once. And that was with my wife, our roommate, and his girlfriend. And just did not feel like previous Mario Party titles. They changed the formula too much.
So, oh, yeah.
You know,
there's a rumor going around. Don't put too much stock in any rumors, of course, that they're not going to have that whole... They're going to go back to a more traditional system of play for Mario Party in future titles, say, on the Switch.
So
I don't know if that's true or not.
So stuff more like Mario Party that was on the GameCube, the Wii, and the N64? The good Mario Party?
Yeah, exactly.
See, that would be good. And that perfectly leads us into our next topic. This was a community topic. Not sure who posted this one on the subreddit, but it's the Nintendo leak culture. And it's not like Nintendo... Maybe it's just because I read more Nintendo news, but it feels like Nintendo has the most supposed leaks or in people wanting leaked information about games and the system and everything. It's ridiculous. If you remember the rumors surrounding that January Mini Direct and how everybody and their pet was predicting what day that this Mini Direct was going to be on. And it just seems like it's gone up from there. You know, the hype, the hype was always pretty high, but like the supposed leaks of what the NX was going to be before we found it was the Switch. You know, then there was this a Direct that was supposedly going to happen in February. It's now March 3rd. There's no Direct in February, so all those people saying, yep, you know, when it was going to happen.
And then it's just time zones, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Of course. It'll be in February. Maybe February 2023.
Yeah. You know, and then we've got people like Emily Rogers and Marcus Sellers who are supposedly big leakers, and they've got all this inside information, yet the number of times that they have been wrong is astronomical. They're correct very few times, and most of the time when they are correct, it's because it was information that had already been released somewhere else. Just maybe not to much fanfare, you know, it was quietly released, you know. So like Marcus Sellers, in fact, I hadn't even heard of him before, but so far some of his leaks, things like the Bandai Namco event in December 15th, Call of Duty coming to the Switch, Vanquish 2, Mario Party 11, like these are all games that he's saying, you know, things that have happened or will happen and nothing. You know, and then people make excuses for leakers. You know, what do you think about this whole leak culture?
So honestly, I don't like it all too much at all. I gave you that little Mario Party shred of hope earlier, even though I'm pretty sure that's a Marcus Sellers rumor as well.
Probably could be the
whole thing about going back to a more traditional thing. Just to hopefully make you feel a little better about the future of Mario Party. I think that there's no real point of having all of these rumors. I understand the hype, but I feel like there's another, especially right now with how big the Switch is and how much news in general is coming out for the Switch, that we don't really need to have all of these rumors. Back in the NX days, before... before the Switch was revealed as the Switch, I could understand why there was why there were all these rumors and why there was so much hype. This was something completely new. It was uncharted territory. What could possibly be on the Switch? So it was fun going around and dreaming up what could possibly be on the Switch, or I mean on the NX. But more in like a sort of schoolyard, elementary playground manner, rather than saying, "Oh no, this is exactly what's going to be on the Switch." You know, my uncle from Nintendo told me that's what this feels like. It feels like my uncle from Nintendo, but online rather than by the swing set.
Yeah, well, and you mentioned like back during you know the NX days, and that's it's almost like people are taking their wish list and trying to turn it into fact. You know, it's that whole wish list thing, and maybe that's where it should stay. Keep it as a wish list. Don't start saying that. Yeah, this is going to happen because it's you're going to get called out on it. And I think as gamers, and the fact that you know social media sites such as Twitter, like Twitter's become you know is quite big. We need to also start holding these supposed leakers and people that have this information accountable, because they build such a huge following, claiming you know all of this stuff, and then nothing. Wasn't there something that happened on, was it the Switch or the NX subreddit? Somebody joined, claiming that they were a developer, and was revealing all this information about the system. And it ended up being picked up by a bunch of gaming websites. And I think it had traction for maybe a day before people finally debunked it.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember who it was. But yeah, I kind of remember that.
That happens so often. There's so many different things that are like that. I remember in one particular case, I don't know if it's the one that you're referring to, they even supposedly got verified by the moderators of Nintendo NX.
Yes, I think we're talking about the same thing. I think that might be the same one. And then it got proven that whole thing, everything of it about that was fake. But I mean, that just goes to show you how easily it is to make up a supposed fact, and how quickly and easily people believe it.
Yeah, it reminds me of back a few years ago, back when Super Smash Bros. For 3DS and Wii U was really big.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, there's a guy, Artsy Omni, who made a really convincing Rayman fake for the game, saying that, oh, it would be Rayman was coming out to Super Smash Bros. For Wii U and 3DS. And it actually got so popular that Ubisoft even said, "Oh, so okay, on Monday we will have a statement about Rayman for Super Smash Brothers."
Yeah.
And then over the weekend, RC Omni said, "Oh yeah, guys, this is fake. This is why you shouldn't believe everything you see." And Ubisoft just went silent.
I kind of remember that. Yes, I do. I kind of remember that. But I'm kind of glad. I kind of like Nintendo's stand on all this stuff. Anytime somebody reaches out to them for you know information about a supposed leak, it's like we do not comment on this stuff. And I think that's good. I think gamers need to just enjoy what they have. They need to enjoy. I mean, the Switch has got a massive library. Its momentum just seems to be increasing. Everybody, like, I know a ton of people are looking forward to E3 this year because we're getting. It's in a few months, and you know, people are hoping to hear more about Metroid Prime 4, Pokemon Switch. I'm really hoping that we'll hear about an Animal Crossing Switch. You know, so I think it's one thing to get hyped for that and what you hope to hear, but just enjoy what you've got, you know, because we got a lot.
Yeah, exactly. And if you keep hoping for something new, you won't even want to think about the games that are already out. And there's so many good games out. I think as of this 1-year anniversary, there are over 300 games on the Nintendo Switch, I believe. Yeah, and I mean, some of them, albeit, are like shovelware and not that great, but there's a lot of quality in there as well.
Yeah, the shovelware is something that I was thinking about the other day. Because of the popularity of the Switch, that reminds me of the Wii. The Wii had a was hugely popular as well. I think it sold the most consoles in its generation. And the amount... the amount of shovelware was unbelievable. Like, that console had so much crap on it. So much. And... you know, I really don't want to see that happen to the Switch because it is such a great little system. You know, I've got a 3D. Do you have a 3DS?
Yeah, I have a 3DS.
Like, I've got one
on
as
me right now.
No, yeah, no. Like, I've got one as well, and I've kind of playing it to slow down, but that's got a pretty massive library, and you know, I think there's a lot of shovelware on that system as well. But I mean, that could also be partly due to its lifespan, you know, and whatnot. I'm trying to pull up how many games there was on the Switch. I'm on Nintendo's website right now. But, you know, I think it just kind of comes down to it. Just enjoy what we've got. Don't worry about what supposedly is coming down the pipe. You know, it's one thing to get excited for what's already been unveiled, but just, you know, let it be. Enjoy what we have.
In terms of the Switch, I think Nintendo is doing a good job at culling the amount of shovelware. Besides, I mean, they can only do so much seeing how popular the Switch is. They want more games to be released all the time for it, to an extent. Yeah. But also the fact that there's not backwards compatibility is helping them out a lot in terms of culling that sort of shovelware, because you were talking about the 3DS, right? And part of the shovelware on the 3DS is the fact that the DSi eShop, or the DSi shop, I don't think it was called an eShop back then.
Yeah,
all of those games are on the 3DS eShop.
Yeah. Well, I would say that wraps it up for this episode of Hello Nintendo. I'd like to thank Amogh again for taking some time out of your busy school day for joining me on the podcast.
Hey, of course.
So, Amogh, where could people find you if they wanted to connect with you?
So, obviously, Reddit, u/caststarman, as well as I'm thinking about maybe getting back into Twitter, same handle, caststarman, and maybe me saying it on here will finally be the push to get me to start using Twitter a little more again.
It's a good platform for networking. I've met I've had quite a few good connections through Twitter, so highly recommend getting into it, but just keep an eye out for all the crap that's out there.
Right.
I can be found on Twitter as well. My Twitter is ReggieFizaMeme. You can also catch me on Twitch at twitch.tv/trainass. I'm streaming Tuesdays and Thursday evenings, and usually playing primarily more classic games, but actually Thursday I decided to play some Overwatch because I was on an Overwatch kick. And you can also find me on Reddit under Trainass, so you can always hit me up there. So be sure to tune into our next episode where we're going to ask the question yet again that's been echoed since the dawn of gaming. Is Nintendo doomed?
Dun dun dun.
We'll see you next time on Hello Nintendo.
Nintendo!